Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. church. He bore it upon himself, upon the cross. Thank you. in Christ. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were false, have been brought near by the blood of Christ. The blood has brought you near. The Message translation says this, but don't take any of this for granted. Don't take any of this for granted. It was only yesterday that you, outsiders to God's ways, had no idea of any of this. Didn't know the first thing about the way God works. Hadn't the faintest idea of Christ. You knew nothing of that rich history of God's covenants and promises in Israel. Hadn't a clue about what God was doing in the world at large. Now, somebody say now.
Now.
Because of Christ.
Because of Christ.
He says now because of Christ. Dying that death. Because of Christ dying that death. Shedding that blood. You who were once out of it altogether. You who were once out of it altogether. Are in on everything.
Thank you, Lord.
God has brought you in on everything. You are in on everything. Every promise that God has made, you are in it. It is yours for the taking. It is yours for the keeping. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, we thank you this morning for the bread that we break and eat. This cup of drink that we bless and drink, that it becomes for us the very body and blood of your Son Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you this morning, Lord, as you will bless this bread, bless this cup, that Lord God, we will identify with all that which Christ purchased for us. And made it freely available unto us by the grace of God. We have been saved by the grace of God. We have been healed and delivered. So we thank you this morning for the blood of Jesus. In your precious name we thank you, Lord Jesus. And God's people said
Amen.
Hallelujah. You may eat the body of Christ Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your blood which has brought us near. Thank you for your blood which has paid the price for us in full. In your name we pray. God's people say, Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Can we give the Lord praise this morning?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Well, good morning, everybody. I greet you all in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Praise your name, Lord Jesus. Blessed be your holy name. It's good to be in church.
Amen.
I said it's good to be in church. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. I just want to share something with you this morning. From the book of Romans, chapter number 8. Romans 8. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You know, I thank God for His word. Because His word is the truth. And to know His word is to know the truth. He says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free.
Yes, amen.
The truth shall set you free. Romans 8:1, the Bible tells us this. He said, there is a sentence waiting judgment. But the price has been paid, the judgment has been made at the cross. He said there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh on account of sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement of the law may be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. The Message translation, I'm reading from two because I want to try and open your eyes to something. It says, with the arrival of Jesus, the Messiah, that faithful dilemma is resolved. That faithful dilemma is resolved. Those who enter into Christ's being here for us. Those who enter into Christ's being here for us no longer have to live under a continuous low-lying black cloud. A new power is in operation. I like that. A new power is in operation. The Spirit of life in Christ, like a strong wind, has magnificently cleared the air, freeing you from a fated lifetime of brutal tyranny at the hands of sin and death. God went for the jugular when he sent his own Son. He didn't deal with the problem as something remote and unimportant. In his Son Jesus, God personally took on the human condition, entered the disordered mess of struggling humanity in order to set it right once and for all.
Amen.
He set it right once and for all. The law of reason, as it always was by fractured human nature, could never have done that. It could never have done that. There is no condemnation. Tell your neighbor, you are free. Tell somebody, you are free. Yes. Satan has no hold over you. Sin has no hold over you. Hallelujah. I want to share with you in Luke's Gospel, chapter number 19. Luke's Gospel, chapter 19, and I want to read verse number 10. The Bible says, this is Jesus speaking. He says, for the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost.
Thank you, Lord.
I thank God that our Bibles, which is His Word, says he came to seek and to save. He didn't just come seeking, but he came seeking to save. To save what? That which was lost. This account in Luke's Gospel, chapter 19, has got to do with a young man, a man by the name of Zacchaeus. The Bible describes Zacchaeus as being a short man.
Yes.
A short man who heard about Jesus, and when he heard that Jesus was coming, he climbed into the sycamore tree.
Yeah.
So that he could see him.
Yeah.
And probably also so that he could hide from the clouds.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. It hasn't changed. Jesus is still seeking today. Jesus is still saving today. how many times there was something that you misplaced? You misplaced it. You lost it. And now you need it urgently. As a matter of urgency, you have need of that thing. How many times has that happened to you? And I found that every time that happened to me, it's like I turned the entire house, not just my wardrobe, but the entire house upside down. Looking for that which you thought you lost, which you misplaced. You look for it. And then you end up speaking like the world. Oh, it's so true. When you don't look for something, you find it. It's there, but now when you need it, you don't find it. And you start turning everything upside down. You even go looking in places where you wouldn't even store that thing. It doesn't belong in the kitchen, but you go look in the kitchen. Come on, somebody. You take every garment of clothing out and you check the pockets, you check everything. And then when you find it, when you find it, the whole house must know. Yeah. I found it. Mm-hmm. I found it. Yeah. How much listen? When the Lord is seeking, He's seeking. You hear His voice. Do you respond or do you hide? Let me show you something. Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. We're going to come back to Luke 19 shortly. But Genesis 3. Verse number 8. Now this we know the account of the fall of man, Adam and Eve. How they found out that they were naked. Then they go and they take the fig leaves and they make coverings for themselves. Why the fig? Because fig has medicinal properties. Biblical times we use the fig for boils. So, in other words, Adam and Eve actually knew that their state had changed. They were now naked, they were now exposed, and they were in need of healing. They were in need of healing. So they found the fig tree, and they thought that would cover their nakedness. And then verse 8, and they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. Wow, they heard the sounds. It's similar to Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus heard that Jesus was coming that way. And when Zacchaeus heard, Zacchaeus ran and he climbed the sycamore tree so he could see Jesus.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. When he seeks you, to seek means to go after the intention of finding.
Dining
with the Lord. Let me tell you, brother, let me tell you, sister, it is It's a sumptuous feast. Whatever you need, he'll provide it on the table. Whatever you are in need of, he will provide it. He's a God who provides. You know, many guests come. They come to your house, they come to your place to eat. But when Jesus comes, he comes to give.
Yeah.
So that you may eat of him. Fuck Jesus. That's a lie. Says, come unto me, all you who are weak and heavy laden. Come and take my yoke upon you. Come and eat of me. Learn of me. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. He comes and he provides. Very often we go out of our way for guests. And you think, what does this person love? And you try and make everything that this person loves. The glory and the beauty of the gift we have in Jesus is that he comes with everything you need, and he knows everything there is to know about you. There is nothing that you can hide from him, for he knows through it. Adam and Eve hear the sound of God in the cool of the day. Watch this. In the cool of the day, man, they were actually in the heat. The coolness of the day speaks of rest. Speaks of rest. Speaks of refreshing, being refreshed. And they hear the sound. Adam says, watch, the Bible says they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. They, in other words, they tried to use the trees as cattle. You know what's cattle? If you watch the soldiers, they have camel clothing, many of them wear them, and you often see them, they wear the camel so that if you're in the bush, nobody can see them. But little did they know that they were not created to blend in, but to stand out. You see that? God did not create you to blend in. He created you to stand out. He says, come out from among them and be separate, be holy. For the Lord your God is holy. He's a holy God and he's holy. You're a holy child of his. To be holy means to be separated from. It means that there's a distinction. So you were born again. You were created to stand out. Then the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, Adam! Adam! You're probably sitting here this morning. God is calling out to you this morning. Adam! Where are you? Where are you? God is spirit. Man was created in the image and the likeness of God. Man is spirit. The real you is not this flesh. It's not the person that you see in the mirror. The real you is the spirit that is in this tent. Now that spirit was disconnected from God. Hence we find God asks, Adam, where are you? Because you're supposed to be near, but now you're far. Where are you? Adam says, I heard your voice in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. The Lord said to him, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you that you should not eat it? have you eaten of the tree? I commanded you not to eat of it. Simple question. What's the answer? That question is a yes and no. It's either yes or no. Have you eaten? Yes, I ate. God didn't ask why did you eat. He asked, have you eaten? Adam says, the woman you begged to be with me, she gave me of the tree and I ate. He blames God. He blames God. Yet, God was, come on, talk to me, somebody. Whose decision was it to eat? It was Adam's. And now he blames, he says, God was happy eaten. He says, the woman you gave me. How does he say? You see this woman you gave me? That's where the problem is. The woman is the problem. But not only the woman, you also the problem, God, because why did you give this woman to me? If it wasn't for this woman, I wasn't going to eat. He blames God. And we find there are folk like that in life. They blame God for everything that happens to them under the sun. He blames the woman that God had given to him. And then God says to the woman, what is this that you have done? And then the woman, she blames the serpent. She says, the serpent deceived me and I ate. I left South Africa You don't know what makes it clean. When you get these, oh Lord, what have I done? What have I done? You'll serve the Lord because some brother, some sister, some pastor, or some church, quit blaming the church for your spiritual condition. Quit blaming the pastor for your spiritual condition. Quit blaming everybody else for your condition.
Thank you.
than what you think with your flesh.
Yeah.
Jesus said to Zacchaeus, he said, the Son of Man came to seek out. See, God, listen, God sought you out. It means to be sought out means to be handpicked. To be picked up. I mean, listen, Jesus was walking. Thousands were around him. There's one man in the tree that didn't even think that Jesus would take note of him. Jesus could have stayed at anybody's house. He could have stayed at anybody's house. He could have.
Yeah.
He could have stayed at anybody's house. But he chose one. Jesus knew already when he was going, he must dwell at Zacchaeus' house. He must dine at Zacchaeus' house.
Yeah.
And he says to you this morning, I picked you out.
Thank you, Lord.
Come down from wherever you are. He says, come out from wherever you are. Quit being like Adam. Quit being like Eve. You see, Zacchaeus came down. Zacchaeus didn't have excuses. Oh Lord, you can't go because of A, B, C, and D. Zacchaeus received him. And let me tell you something. When Jesus comes under your roof, when Jesus comes and talks to me, somebody, when Jesus comes to dine in your house, when he comes to you in your heart, when you receive Jesus, there's a change. There's a lasting change. It's not a temporal change. It's a permanent change. The people of the world will see all your mistakes and faults that you made. But Jesus doesn't see that. He sees the completed work. When he died with Zacchaeus, the Bible says Zacchaeus started taking a really big money. He started taking it out. And he says, see, Lord, if I've robbed anybody, I'm giving them.
Yeah.
I'm giving to the poor. You get to a point when you are in Christ that you cannot hold and harbor unforgiveness in your life. You start letting go. You see, the minute you start letting go, the people that you fail to forgive, you know they're free. They're all free. They're all living their lives. And you think, oh, yeah, the fuck is cut every time if I'm not hating them and I'm not speaking to them and I'm not because it's only me, I'm the main man. But it might be firm. I'm the main one.
That person is free.
You're the one that's in the prison of unforgiveness. And you wonder why so many things happen in your life. You know, let me share something with you. There's great power in forgiveness. There are people that experience heart conditions. They get cancers and all these sorts of things purely because of unforgiveness. Unforgiveness is a cancer.
Amen.
It's a cancer. To have unforgiveness is to pronounce a prison sentence on yourself. Let go today. Because Zacchaeus is the descendant of Abraham.
Amen.
We are all the seed of Abraham.
Yes.
And heirs according to the promise. Come on, somebody.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. The Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. Hallelujah. People have lost their joy. They've lost so many things. But if you can just allow Jesus, your joy will return, your peace will return, the love will return, those dreams you once had that you had, every time. Because when you have Jesus, he kindles a flame within you. You desire to be with him and him only. Hallelujah. He came to seek and to save.
Yes.
The word save is a word in Greek, sozo. Sozo means to be saved, to be healed, and to be delivered.
Amen.
That is what Christ has done for us. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Come on, give the Lord praise this morning. People don't really know what to say from. I've been saved from sin. I've been healed. I've been delivered. It's time to tell the world. People say, but how is that possible? It's in the Jesus I serve. He does it. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Amen. Praise the Lord. I'm going to give you the volume of the offering. When she's done, I'll do the final blessing. Amen. Please remember, when we leave the premises, we will leave at the exit, the side of the
room.
Amen. So when you come up for your tithes, your offerings, you will do so as we leave the church. You can put it in the tithing box there at the exit, sanitize your hand, and no social meetings. Amen.
Amen. I greet you all in the name of our wonderful Lord and Savior Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
I will read for the word for the offering this morning. It is titled Christ-Centered Prosperity. Christ-Centered Prosperity. Amen. John 3 John chapter 1 verse 2 says, Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. Amen. When Christ is the center of prosperity, prosperity, which includes success, it is the finished work of Jesus Christ. To receive this finished work, we position ourselves to hear from the Holy Spirit. When we receive a word from the Holy Spirit, we obey it. We can expect to see supernatural results. With his blood, Jesus paid the price for our sins, healing, righteousness, and prosperity. If we believe his sacrifice that paid for our sins and deliverance, we can also believe that his blood has paid for our prosperity. We can ask ourselves the following. Do I trust my own ability where sin is concerned? Do I trust my own ability where healing is concerned? Do I trust my own ability where prosperity is concerned? Prosperity is a finished work just as much as salvation, healing, righteousness, and deliverance. Our faith works when we know that we are God's beloved. Prosperity is not limited. We can prosper in every way. However, we prosper as our souls prosper. The soul is comprised of the mind, will, and emotions. And the Lord cannot prosper without the knowledge of the word. Amen.
Amen.
Shall we stand to say the declaration of faith?
Amen.
I choose to receive my prosperity and come out of lack and insufficiency. My salvation came with my prosperity, and I take hold of it. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Jesus.